this is where I had my basic training as an aviation cadet down at Maxwell Field. I joined a B-25 bomber group in July of 1942, and we went overseas in September of 42, first to England, and then down to Africa with the invasion of Africa, landing at Oran, and our first airport was at a town south of Oran called Tafraoui. While we were there, life was a little difficult because North Africa can be cold in the winter and it can be hot in the summer. It has a lot of rain and it gets very muddy, particularly on an airfield. In the beginning, we slept in tents that were not, they were shelter halves actually. We would dig a hole down about 3 or 4 feet, depending on how ambitious you were. Put the tent over that and put a sleeping bag in it. And when there was an air raid, instead of getting up, then getting out into the dark and all, why, we would just put our helmets back on and go back to sleep. Finally, they gave us pyramidal tents, which housed four officers, and that wasn't so bad. Here's a picture of a pyramidal tent with four occupants, one of them happens to be me. We got a shower about once a week, maybe if we were lucky. In the meantime, we would shave and wash out of our steel helmets. Steel helmet was used for a lot of things, for heating water, for cooking, many things. It was a very handy thing. The Germans were having to move armament and food and other supplies from Italy down to Africa to feed the Africa Corps, Rommel's troops. And they had to come down by ship. So we would go out on what we called sea sweeps. Usually it would be a 6-ship formation. And when we sighted them, why, we would bomb them and strafe them. After a while, the Germans gave these ships more protection. They would have armed patrol boats with the transport ships, and we caught a lot of hell. And we lost a lot of airplanes during this campaign. At one time while we were in Africa, the Germans almost broke through at a point called the Kasserine Pass. Fortunately, the 5th Army of the United States beat the Germans at Kasserine Pass, and therefore we slowed down their movement toward the west. Picture here of German Ju-52s loaded with gasoline and armament flying in formation from Italy to Africa and being jumped by a group of B-25s who shot down the whole damn fleet of jumpers 52s. This is a corrugated airplane that was used for transport. That was a big loss to the Germans because we had raised so much hell with their shipping that they had gone to the air transport. And now that we knocked them out too, they were in bad shape. The Germans finally left Africa at Cape Bon, and after they did, while we had a big celebration on our field, I have pictures of the commanding general giving out medals to the combat crews and what have you. There's another picture, rather typical of Africa, with sheep and camels walking along the road. We had some of our airplanes, of course, came in and belly landed. Maybe their gear couldn't come down or something, and they would tear up the nose and the engines, and our crews would put most of, if they couldn't put them together, they would use them for spare parts, but they did a fine job of keeping the airplanes flying. While we're in Africa, we were visited by Bob Hope and his crew. I have pictures of Bob Hope and Francis Langford, Tony Romano, entertaining us. The boys really enjoyed that. I think it was a great, great thing for Bob Hope to do. While we're in Africa, we got the first group of B-25s with a cannon in the nose. And they landed at our airfield in Africa. And after they landed, we had a very bad rainstorm. And the field got so muddy that the planes sunk down into the mud and couldn't be flown out under their own power. So we arranged to get tractors to pull them out. When the tractors pull the planes out of the mud, they pull them up on the highway. The highway was a two-lane road. And it ran just so far, and then the road turned. And we measured it off, and if the planes didn't get off, by the time they hit the turn, they were in trouble. And we posted a 50-gallon drum at a point where they had to get their wheels up. All the planes were able to take off within that space, and we got them down to this airfield for the retraction test. The Romans did a lot of building of aqueducts in Africa. They had to bring water from the hills into the cities, like into Tunis. And I have pictures of these aqueducts that are still standing in part that carried this water. Our group was made up of men who had been on the original Tokyo mission. Most of them became either squadron commanders or group or squadron navigators and bombardiers. And because of this, we had a good, solid group. Our cooks managed to put together a Christmas dinner, usually rubber turkeys and the fixings. But it was good. It was something different. When the African-Tunisian war was over, campaign was over, we moved to Corsica, which is a nice little island that's set up close to southern France, just north of Sardinia. And we had a very nice field there. And our people built an officer's club and dining room. The headquarters officers had a little compound of their own, and they called it Jackass Meadows. And that was because a lot of little Corsican jackasses that would run around, they'd stick their head in your tent flap and bray at you in the middle of the night. So we call it Jackass Meadows. I have a picture of the inside of the mess hall. It's really quite something because the place is decorated with pictures taken on R&Rs from different locations like Cairo, and they've been made into lamps hung on the walls. There's long tables and chairs for banquets, and there's a fireplace, a bar. There's an engine to sell in the ceiling that's used with a light. Very well done. More party pictures. And more party pictures. We must have had a wonderful time over there. We had really enjoyed Corsica. We were there for a year. And we did a lot of bombing of North Italy. Southern Italy too, because we were well north of the bomb line when we were in Corsica. This is taken from a flight behind a flight that's going into a heavy bombardment of Akak. The sky is just dark with it. Once the flight left their IP point, the initial point, they flew straight and level to the target, so that while they were on their target run, they could not take evasive action and were subject to being hit by this flak, and many were. We had a Red Cross unit assigned to our group. There was a woman in charge of the group, and there were four girls that worked with them. They would serve coffee and donuts in the morning to the crews when they came back from their mission. In general, they were very helpful. Now I'm looking at pictures, before and after pictures, that were taken from cameras in the airplanes that shot pictures directly down. One photo shows a bridge that's in very good shape going across the river, and the next photo shows that same bridge being bombed, and it's just covered with bombers. The B-25 was a good solid airplane. It took the beating and quite often got home with serious damage. I'm looking at a picture of the plane that has its left wing half shot off, and it made it back to the base. I was an intelligence officer, group intelligence officer. I'm looking at pictures that show the planning of the 500th mission of the 310th Bomb Group, of which I was a part of. The commanding general of our wing and our commanding officer of our group came into my war room, and with the navigator, group navigator and group bombardier, we plotted the mission, taking into consideration the best entrance and exit of into the target, keeping in mind flak positions and also enemy airports. The crew gets briefed after the planning is all done. They are handed out kits that contain maps and safety gear and escape equipment. And after the briefing is over, they are taken in trucks out to their airplanes. The airplanes take off and circle and form in their formation over the field, and then are on their way to the target. This is a picture of them coming back and being photographed. These are pictures of the squadron commanders all sweating out their groups to see that their men all came back safely. The first airplane lands and is taxied up, and he's parked. The crew comes out, and the airplane and is greeted by the commanding general of the wing and the CO of the group. They are congratulated for a job well done, back in the trucks and brought back up to headquarters, where they are treated by the Red Cross to coffee and donuts, and then are interrogated by the squadron intelligence officers to determine what went on during the mission and what was accomplished and what was seen. These reports are gathered and sent up to me for consolidation. After I do consolidate it, I share the information with a liaison officer from the 8th Army, who then gives the information to his superiors. There are a lot of pictures being taken because this is the first bomb group to have accomplished 500 missions in the Italian campaign. The group has a photo group. They have equipment for all kinds of photography, both the large cameras that take the direct pictures of the bomb groups going down, movie cameras that take pictures of the 50 caliber machine guns being shot at fighters coming in, and they supply other cameras for men who go along as observers, which I did many times. Now, every once in a while, we would get what we call as R&R, rest and recreation, and we would go to nice places like either Rome or Cairo, or I'm looking at a lot of pictures that are taken in Rome. These are taken with a speed graphic, I believe.